the dawn of pediatrics, in his soft and humorous yet elegant way, will enlighten us.
Well, I think after what we saw, the presentation of how important is history and physical examination and how small little things make a lot of difference, I thought I would just talk about just one skill that a clinician must develop, and that is one of observation. I just want to share how much can observation make us wiser, and I will just take you through some of the common situations where just a mere observation can almost make a final diagnosis, even if you did not know any history or even if you'd never touched a patient. And I think what was said just now was that just seeing is not exactly observing. And I think when you learn to observe, you are very keenly looking at some clues that come through. For example, this is a child, 2 6-year-old children presented with purpura. Now, you knew that they had purpuric spots, but just by looking at them from a distance, if one was sick, then you knew that he had a bone marrow disease or he may have a meningococcemia, and if the other was comfortable, you know he had an ITP. We are all taught as undergraduates that the examination starts just by first observation. And looking at him, whether he is comfortable or sick, almost gives you a possibility of what he probably has. Look at these two children who came, three of them came with edema. One of them is acutely sick. He's probably a capillary leak. Another is chronically sick. He's probably a chronic liver disease. And a third is very comfortable and happy. He's a nephrotic syndrome. How important it is just to see how the child looks at it. Having said this, let me take you to a specific situation where even again an observation can make a lot of importance. And these kind of patients teach us how much we can observe and what all things we need to learn to observe. This is a 6-month-old child who was seen to be breathing fast. Now, when you see a child breathing fast, can you make a probable diagnosis just by looking at him? What all do we want to observe? We want to know whether he's well nourished. If he's well nourished, obviously he has very likely a recent acute illness. You want to know whether he's very sick looking. If he's not very sick looking, then very likely he doesn't have an acute bacterial infection. You want to know whether he has a chest retraction. If he doesn't have a chest retraction, it almost rules out a large airway disease or even for that matter a lung disease like a pneumonia, who would have obviously some retraction if he's breathing fast. So now he has no sound while breathing, he has no stridor, wheeze or grunt that almost rules out an upper airway, lower large airway or a parenchymal disease. This is just by observation. If you therefore saw that he was well nourished, he was not very sick, so probably he didn't have an acute infection, he did not have an airway problem, larger airway, he did not have a lung parenchyma airway, so he had an acute bronchiolitis. We are not here not to examine a patient, we are not here to take a detailed history, but we are just trying to say that if a good clinician does a lot of experiments with his own skills, he can just one do an experiment that you just take a history and give a diagnosis. Another one could be just observe and consider a diagnosis. Each one of these components of clinical examination has so much to offer that if we combine all that, you can imagine how much more you can do much before you plan an investigatory test. Let's look at the next one. Another 6-month-old is breathing fast. Now you have known what you want to observe in a child who is breathing fast. He's malnourished. It almost means that he has got a chronic progressive disease. He's sick looking. He could be having an acute bacterial infection or he's already in an organ failure. He has chest retraction, which are subcostal and intercostal. So probably he has a severe disease involving the airway and a lung parenchyma. And then therefore he has a chronic progressive lower respiratory tract disease with probably an acute infection. If you just knew this by observation, you were worried whether this child has a cystic fibrosis or an immune deficiency. Just by looking at the basic things. Let's see the next one. Another one who is breathing fast. Now this child is malnourished. So obviously he has a chronic progressive illness. He is not very sick looking. So probably he doesn't have an acute bacterial infection. He has no chest retraction. So that almost rules out an upper large airway, lung parenchyma, etc. He has a deep rapid respiration without respiratory distress. So he has a sign acidosis. Now you know that he has a chronic progressive, non-infective acidosis. At 6 months, you have diagnosed him as a renal tubular acidosis. In each case, you knew what you are looking at, and in each case, you knew exactly what one investigation, if required, you would do, or one focused clinical examination maneuver that almost confirms what you just observed. Imagine we have not even had a history. Add a history to it, you would know almost everything. Look at this child. He was also breathing fast. Now, he was malnourished, so he had a chronic progressive disease. He was not sick looking, so probably he didn't have a bacterial infection. He had a subcostal and intercostal chest retraction. It almost meant that he had an airway and a lung parenchyma involvement. If that was so, then we knew that, look at the precordium. The precordium was pulsatile. What does the pulsations over the precordium mean? There is probably a volume overload. Look at this child who has got a respiratory problem. He's not very sick looking, but he's certainly having a chronic progressive disease, and he has got a precordial pulsations suggesting that there is a volume overload. You have diagnosed him as a left to right shunt with a pulmonary edema, and therefore this is the way you can almost say that this is the child breathing fast because of the heart disease. What have you added on this child? You also looked carefully at the precordium. You could have picked up a precordial bulge maybe, or you saw in this child a precordial pulsations, and you knew that a silent precordium in a heart disease as against a pulsatile precordium in a heart disease makes a lot of importance in just observing whether you are seeing a pulsations or otherwise. Let's see this child now. This child looks cyanotic. Can we make a diagnosis of a cyanotic heart disease? This 6-month-old infant looks cyanotic. He was malnourished, so he probably had some chronic disease. He was not sick looking, so he didn't have an acute exacerbation of his problem, or he didn't have an acute infection. He didn't have a chest retraction, so he didn't have a significant airway or a lung parenchyma. He had a silent precordium, so he had no volume overload. You had almost diagnosed him as a phallus just by looking at him again. Let's look at some other scenarios. We showed you how a child with a respiratory distress of varieties of condition, almost everything that you saw normally in clinical practice, you could merely observe the way he was breathing, and you could almost diagnose a respiratory disease, a cardiac disease, a child with a renal tubular acidosis. What more do you want in routine practice? I think if we master the most common condition that we just pick up, even by observation, then I think it's very, very important. I do this with passion on my rounds. I tell the residents once in the first 5 cases, just tell me the history and give me your diagnosis. Maybe in the next 5 cases, just observe and talk what you are observing. I think it's a good way of training as well as training yourself. And I know that some of them would come brilliantly with this. I would certainly say that this sensitizes people to observe. We knew as undergraduate that we were taught how to inspect, palpate, percuss. But inspection was different than observation. You know, inspectors of varieties of agencies which go around do not observe anything. So what is inspection? Observation is something much different, as he put up so many things and each one had a different meaning. Let's see whether we can diagnose an abdominal distension by looking at it. Again, I'm not trying to say that you don't do anything else in clinical medicine. Here is just to convince you that each part of the clinical medicine has such a tremendous power. that an observation has a very strong power of making a diagnosis, and many times we don't use that. And I think that is what probably is the purpose of such presentation. This 4-year-old child came with abdominal distension. It looked like a generalized distension with fullness in the flanks. It almost means a probable ascites. He looked normal in nutrition, so which means that he has no chronic disease. He was not sick, so he didn't have an acute disease or infection. He had no edema, so he didn't have any localized pathology. Now look at this. He has an ascites. He is not sick. He has not a chronic problem as we see. He has good nutrition. He has no edema. That takes away almost your liver disease, cardiac disease, a kidney disease. They will all be sick when they have an ascites, and he had no edema at all. What does this mean to you? This means it could be a Bhatchari, or it could be a big mesenteric cyst, or it could be a nephrotic syndrome who is already treated, where ascites is yet to disappear and the peripheral edema is gone. You could come so close to by just knowing that this is likely to be ascites, and an ascites in a child who doesn't look to be sick, who doesn't look to be malnourished, he is happy, normal, and you almost make a diagnosis. All that you needed was just to check for the liver. If the liver was large, it was probably a Bhatchari. If there's a history of previous edema generalized, you knew it was a nephrotic syndrome, or otherwise it could have been a large cyst as well. Let's look at this other fellow. This is another 4-year-old with abdominal distension. He has an upper abdominal distension, clearly meaning that he has got an enlarged liver, maybe with or without splenomegaly. He was not sick, so he didn't have an acute illness. But his growth was poor, so he has got a chronic disease. So he has got a chronic disease with liver enlarged, may also be spleen. He has an edema of it, so he has hypoproteinemia. He almost got a diagnosis. There's no jaundice, nor significant pallor. So there's no liver cell failure, nor any hematological disease. And therefore, he has got a compensated liver disease. Let's look at the other one. So we saw abdominal distension, who had only a mesenteric cyst. We could kind of guess that this is not going to be a liver disease or a kidney disease. And we saw another child who obviously looked enlarged liver and a chronically sick child, edema. So we knew that he had a chronic liver disease, but he didn't have jaundice. He was compensated liver disease. Let's see whether we can make out a diagnosis by observation of just a pale child. This is a 2-year-old, looks very pale. His growth is normal, so he doesn't have a very progressive disease. He's not sick, so he doesn't have any organ dysfunction or an acute infection. He's very comfortable, in spite of looking very sick, very pale. So he has got a chronic anemia. If he was looking very pale and he had an acute anemia, he would be certainly breathless, or he would be even in shock. So this child has got a chronic compensated anemia. Because of that, he is still comfortable. He doesn't have any abnormal facies, so he doesn't have a congenital hemolysis. He doesn't have abdominal distension, so he has no liver and spleen. Now you've got so much that this was a severely pale child who had a chronic anemia, well compensated. His growth is fairly normal, and he has no liver and spleen. Now, if you look at severe anemia without liver and spleen, you have two major groups. One is a deficiency anemia, and one may be a bone marrow aplasia. Bone marrow aplasia is sick, so this has to be a deficiency anemia. All that I want to know is that, does he have an iron deficiency or a B12 or a folate? Can I make that also? Yes, could be. There was no purpura, so no bone marrow disease was out. But he had a mild icterus. Now, when everything said that he had only a deficiency anemia, and I found a mild icterus, so I need not push myself into a hemolytic anemia just because there was an icterus, because I've already found that he has no reason to be having any congenital hemolytic anemia. Therefore, I need to find out whether a mild icterus can be even seen in deficiency anemia. And surely this is the B12 deficiency, where occasionally you might have even a mild icterus, a mild jaundice, because of an ineffective erythropoiesis that takes place there. So the point I'm making is that even when there was a mild icterus, as observed, you still did not get away from a previous conclusions that this looked like a deficiency anemia, and you did not just go by a hemolytic anemia, because there is no chronic hemolytic anemia which has no liver and spleen. Let's look at this other child who is pale. This child is malnourished, so he has a chronic disease. This child is sick looking, so he has some serious disease. This child has an upper abdominal distension, so he has very likely a hepatomegaly with or without splenomegaly. Now this child is a sick child, chronic progressive anemia, and with hepatosplenomegaly, he has a purpuric rash. So we already know that he has an abdominal hepatosplenomegaly, and hepatosplenomegaly would mean that either he has a hemolytic anemia or he has a bone marrow infiltrative disease. He has a purpuric skin rash, he's serious, he's sick looking, he's malnourished, obviously he has got a chronic bone marrow disease, and he's got a bone marrow infiltrative disease, and therefore he probably had any of the infiltration. That we won't know what it is, but we already seen how different types of children with pallor can be made out simply by observation. Lastly, let's look at whether we can also guess what's the cause of delayed development in a child by mere observation. This is a 2-year-old child who looks developmentally delayed. His head appears small. So looks like that he had an early onset problem of a brain disease. He had no abnormal physiognomy, so he was not syndromic. He didn't have a chromosomal anomaly. He moved all his limbs, so he had no paresis. He was crossing his legs, so he had a seizuring. He was spastic. A child who had some brain injury very early in life, that's why he was developmentally delayed, and he has spasticity. He didn't have any cranial nerves that you can see. You can really see many cranial nerves by just observation. Common cranial nerves are picked up. If he's crying, you need to see the 7. You see his eye movements, you know 3rd, 4th, 6th there. So common cranial nerves are already picked up. And you see that he has no pooling of his saliva, so you know that his basal cranial nerves are all right. What more do you want in this child? You almost got the whole motor system, you got a cranial nerves, they're all normal. Therefore, this child's growth and nutrition is fair, which means that this is not a progressive disease. One time damage, thereafter he remained reasonably static in his growth. This meant that he had a spastic CP. Just by looking at him, you know that very likely he had a spastic CP. This was another child who was developmentally delayed. He was not sick looking, so he didn't have any active infection or a disease. He was subnormal weight, but near normal length. What did that mean? He probably had not a very chronic disease, if the length looks all right. I know my teacher could almost tell me the weight and length by looking at the child. And he told me that you have seen thousands of children, then your visual impression could even tell me close to few grams of weight and a few centimeters of length by looking at him. And I'm sure that when we start looking at such thing, so on my round, if my resident gives you a totally wrong weight or height, then I know that I ask him to take it again, because you have a visual impression of what length or what weight the child has. And I think this was a child who probably had a recent illness, not very sick. So his illness must have disappeared, and his head looks large. The most common cause of large head is hydrocephalus. He does not move his left upper limb or lower limb. He is hemiparetic. What more do you want? He has had a recent illness from which he seems to have recovered, but he is left behind with a hydrocephalus and a left hemiparesis and a developmental delay. Obviously, in our situation, he has a TBM. Let's look at this one. This child looks severely developmentally delayed. He's wasted and stunted. Looks like a progressive disease, unlike the previous one who had a static disease. So this child has got a serious neurological progressive disease, which has caused a severe developmental delay. Head appears normal, which means that this developmental delay must have started somewhere later in infancy, but not right perinately, or for that matter antenatally. And therefore this child must have born normally, and somewhere down the line in infancy he picked up this kind of a disease which is progressive. He has dystonic anaspastic posture, which you can see simply by observation, which means that he has the pyramidal disease and he has also basal ganglia disease. Now imagine a progressive severe neurological disease, pyramidal basal ganglia involvement, global developmental delay. Now you know that he has also hyperacusis because he suddenly startles with a noise. So you had already made a diagnosis of a neurodegenerative disorder. The point that I'm making is that if you go one step further, neurodegenerative disorder, and even put one more factor, onset of a disease, you almost can guess what kind of a metabolic disorder it could be. For example, if the neuroregression starts way early at about 2, 3, 4 months of age, it's almost a West syndrome or an infantile spasm. Occasionally it could be an infantile gaucus like a big liver and spleen. Many neurodegenerative disorders start between 6 months and 12 months, and you have many of them, like Sandoff and Krabbe's and so on and so forth. You have a neurodegeneration which starts after a year, somewhere year and two. It could be a Rett syndrome in a female, or a Leigh syndrome, mitochondrial encephalopathy. You might have neurodegeneration starting somewhere 3, 4 years of age. You have an adrenoleukodystrophy. And you have a neurodegeneration starting at 8, 10 years of age. You have an SSPE. What more does an average clinician wants to know? He already knows even a probable cause of a neurodegenerative disease. Add one more factor at what age it started, and you almost get the whole story right. This was an 8-month-old child with a delayed milestones. When you saw him, he looked alert and responsive. So obviously he had a normal cognition. When you look at him, he was malnourished. So he has a chronic progressive disease with cognition maintained. So very likely, he doesn't have a global developmental delay, but he probably has just a motor delay. So this is the child with a motor delay and a normal cognition. He has a frog-like posture. So he has a severe hypotonia. He has a severe hypotonia with normal cognition, but he's getting malnourished, which means that the disease is progressive and probably his nutrition is not being kept up. You get the diagnosis now that he has a severe hypotonia with a normal cognition, and this hypotonia is in a small infant. It looks like progressive. That means it must have started very early in life, or maybe even antenatally. And then you saw he had a paucity of limbs. That means he was paretic. If you knew that, he had a low voice, he couldn't cry. That means he had even a respiratory muscle affection, so he had already seen his tongue fasciculation, so you knew that he has an SMA type 1. Just by looking at him, you knew that this is what it is. I thought I just would share some of these observational points. And we saw a child of purpura, which we made up. We saw 5, 6 different types of respiratory distress in small infants, which we could guess whether it was a respiratory, cardiac, or maybe a metabolic. We saw abdominal distension where there was a mesenteric cyst maybe, or another chronic compensatory liver disease. We saw children with pallor where we picked up a vitamin B12 deficiency and a bone marrow infiltrative disease just by observation. And we saw delayed development. We saw spastic CP. We saw neurodegenerative disorder. We saw spinal muscular atrophy. If you ask me as a general pediatrician, what more do I want to know in each topic? I must say that this is all that I wanted to learn by mere observation. And the whole purpose of this presentation was that when we talk about history, physical examination, everything is important. But even in isolation, it may be a good idea to practice isolation skills. I recall Dr. Udani asking me as a registrar just to look at the leg of the child and diagnose. I used to tell him as a registrar, sir, tell me what is wrong with this. I said, no, there is enough for you to see. All that he wanted me to see was, there was erythema nodosum on the leg. And he wanted me to pick up that. And moment I picked up erythema nodosum, you know what were the probable causes of erythema nodosum. That kind of a thing. he would just say that examine the elbow only. Now I didn't know what elbow. I tried movements, and then I did not palpate a supratrochial lymph nodes. That was a syphilis of olden days. I've gone through this kind of an observation. I thought that I would share this kind of a skill. It makes the clinical medicine very enjoyable. When you look at this closely and you start making something out of it, I think you enjoy doing what you do. And I'm sure that this doesn't take time. When you practice, it becomes even a habit. And I'm sure this is worth doing. Thank you very much.